Hello! Today we're going to talk about something a little bit more contemporary and compare how different light sources work and why that means that you can't dim some of them with normal theatrical dimmers. First off, we have our humble light bulb, or as we call it in theater, a lamp. These have a tungsten filament inside a clear envelope, usually filled with an inert gas. The envelope can be made out of glass or quartz, and there can be all sorts of gases inside, including halogens, which are far from inert. Some lamps do still have a vacuum inside, usually smaller, lower wattage lamps or colored lamps for exterior use. This works by running electricity through the filament, which causes it to heat up and eventually start glowing. They use tungsten because it handles the heat well. The upside to this is that incandescent lamps are fairly easygoing about the sort of power they get. AC, DC, they just don't care. If you lower the voltage, they just get dimmer. If you lower the current going to them, they get dimmer. If you take a lamp made for 240 and feed it 120 volts, it just gets dimmer. They do have a tendency to become redder as they get dimmer due to physics. So I've done a number of videos about how we used to dim lights, but I've never really talked about how we do it now. And this is an old CD80, but the basic idea is the same. We just turn the power off for part of each AC wave cycle. So if normal AC current looks like this, if we set the dimmer to 50% power, it looks like this. If we fade from 0% to full, it looks like this. I'm not sure what's going on there, but I probably need to call a service tech. This works fine in a standard incandescent lamp because the filament takes time to warm up and cool down, and that thermal inertia prevents you from seeing the power is being switched on and off. This rapid switching can sometimes cause the filament to vibrate, which is why lamps will sometimes hum or sing when they're dimmed. This is usually worst at 50%. While the humble incandescent lamp has served us well for over a century, there are some problems with it. One, it's very fragile. Both the envelope and the filament are susceptible to breaking, and this kills the lamp. Two, they are ridiculously inefficient. This is the light output of your standard incandescent lamp. This little bit is what we can see. All of this is wasted in just heating things up. So that's not great. And third, they only produce white light, which means that if we want to produce colored beams of light, like we often do in theater, we need to produce white light ridiculously inefficiently, and then filter out the colors that we don't want, turning yet more light into heat. For particularly saturated colors, like deep blues, that can get as low as 5% or even sometimes lower. So hypothetically, let's take a source for 575 watts and put a 5% transmission gel in front of it. Our 575 watts go in, we immediately lose 546 of those watts as heat. We get 29 watts turned into light coming out the front. But it's an even mix of all colors, and all we want is the 5% of it that's blue. So we discard 95% of that as heat, which means we've only actually turned 1.4 watts into light that actually reaches the stage, giving us an astounding 99.8% inefficiency. So for all of those reasons, people started looking for other ways to produce light. And the first one we're going to talk about are fluorescents. These can take the form of these long tubes, like you see in classrooms or offices, or these little soft serve cone CFLs, which stands for compact fluorescent lamp, because, well, they're smaller. These turn about 22% of their power into light, which doesn't sound great, but it's a lot better than an old incandescent lamp. Now, the way these work is a little bit more complicated. There is a filament at each end of the tube, but it doesn't glow. It's just coated in a material that increases its thermionic emission, which is just a fancy way of saying that as it gets warmer, it shoots off more electrons. The inside of the tube is filled with a mix of gases and a tiny drop of mercury. The walls of the tube are coated in a phosphor compound. Now, mercury is not great for you, so be sure you dispose of your tubes properly. There's not enough in there that you should panic and flee the building if you break one, but there is enough that you don't want thousands of them going into a landfill. A fluorescent tube is wired up like this. Your hot comes in through a ballast, goes through a filament, through a starter, through another filament, and then out to your neutral. When you first turn the fluorescent light on, the starter allows power to flow through your two filaments, causing them to warm up and start emitting electrons. After a short period of time, the starter cuts out, which causes a little voltage spike, which causes electricity to flow through the gas, ionizing it and turning it into a conductive plasma. Now, one of the problems with a fluorescent tube is that it actually gets less resistive as more current flows through it, which would then make more current flow through it, which would make it less resistive, which would make more current flow through it. So without this ballast regulating it, it would very rapidly either self-destruct or at least trip the breaker. The electrons pinging through the plasma will occasionally strike mercury atoms. Sometimes this will excite one of the mercury atom's electrons into an unstable state. When it drops back down to its stable state, it emits ultraviolet light. Now, we can't see ultraviolet light, so there is a phosphor coating that intercepts the ultraviolet light, and some of its electrons get raised to excited states and then drop back down, emitting visible light. By carefully picking a mix of ingredients for your phosphor coating, you can produce white light. But what you actually get is this. And this is why you shouldn't do scene painting or makeup or anything involving accurately reproducing colors under fluorescent lights. Yeah, there wasn't an earthquake while I was drawing that, but thank you for your concern. This is also why you'll find a lot of ultraviolet lights that use fluorescent tubes. There are two main types, only one of which you want to use in entertainment. The sort of deep purple black light, that takes the UVC and has a phosphor coating which converts it into UVA, which is the fun ultraviolet light. It's the one that makes things glow and you have a good time. There are also germicidal ultraviolet lights. These have a clear quartz envelope and no phosphor coating. The UVC just comes streaming right out. They will also make things glow, but they will also give you possible eye damage. There is at least one incident where a club decided that they wanted two colors of ultraviolet light and used both of them. Everyone present at the club that night got a free gift of a really bad sunburn. Yeah, I know. I said it was going to be a little more complicated, and then leapt straight off into quantum mechanics, phosphorescence, and thermionic emissions. Sorry. Anyway, given what we now know about the process of making these things light up, what do you think happens when you dim one of them? Actually, it just does this. Nice, smooth dimming. And if you want to see how much fun the dimmer is having doing that, yeah, I'm sure that's healthy. Basically, it works just fine until there isn't enough power to maintain the arc in the tube, at which point the light goes out, and there certainly isn't enough power to start the arc back up again. If you dim them just right, you can sometimes get them to flicker randomly, but you can't really dim them properly, unless you have a special ballast, which then keeps the voltage high enough and maintains the filament temperature while limiting the current that flows through the tube. Depending on the quality of your ballast, at some point they will just snap out. At below a certain level, they just can't maintain that arc, no matter how fancy their circuitry is. On a good ballast, this may be 5%. On the cheaper ones, it may be snapping out at around 20%. Also, if you want a color other than whitish, you need to either have a special phosphor coating or put a gel in front of it, which introduces the same losses we discussed earlier. Before we move on, let's just take a moment to talk about xenon arc lamps, because they actually function closest to a fluorescent light. However, where a fluorescent light, the worst thing about it is that little tiny bit of mercury in there. With a xenon arc lamp, you have two thoriated tungsten electrodes, a fused quartz envelope, and like 400 psi of xenon crammed in there. They may explode violently, so don't mess with them unless you've been trained and are wearing the proper safety equipment. They also emit copious amounts of UVC. That's the bad one. So instruments that are designed to use a xenon arc lamp will have special filters in them so that you don't cook your performers. A xenon arc lamp also requires a ballast to strike and maintain the arc. As far as I know, there's no way to electronically dim one, so if you have an instrument that needs to dim them, they have mechanical shutters that do so. The light goes up. Light goes down. Finally, we get to LEDs. Get ready for more quantum foolishness and phosphorescence. Now, LED stands for light emitting diode. It is a diode that emits light. So right off the bat, it tells you that it's a little bit picky about which way the power flows through it, and it doesn't do its best work when hooked up to AC. Now, the exact functioning of LEDs is a little bit more complicated. But the short version of it is that you have a diode, so you have your two types of semiconductor, and then electrons travel from one over to the other, and as they cross, they drop in energy levels, which causes them to emit a photon. The lowest energy photons are the easiest ones to make, so first came infrared LEDs, then red, then orange, then yellow, then green. Then everything sort of stalled out for a little bit until three guys, whose names I've had to write down, named Shuji Nakamura, Isamu Akasaki, and Hiroshi Amano, managed to discover a viable technique to economically produce blue LEDs. They were awarded the 2014 Nobel Prize in Physics for this, in case you're wondering just how much of a pain it was. Normally, an LED only produces a single wavelength of light. The electrons drop the same amount, they emit photons with the same energy, same color. However, by including a phosphorescent material that reacts with the light produced by your LED, you can produce white light, and they have much better color rendering than fluorescent lights. They're about as efficient, but in theater, they've got one big advantage over everything we've talked about before. They can do additive color mixing. So instead of producing white light and then filtering out the colors that you don't want, wasting that energy as heat, with LED fixtures, you can have red, green, and blue LEDs and only turn on the ones you need. So if we wanted, for example, blue light, we would just turn on the blue LED, saving the power that we would otherwise have wasted, creating all this red and green light we didn't actually even want. Now, these often have problems producing a good white light. So fancier units will have more LEDs. The most common one is RGBW, which is red, green, blue, white. But other units may have as many as 7 different LEDs, each dedicated to their own particular slice of the color spectrum. Now, you can't just plug an LED into a dimmer. First off, it's expecting between 1.8 and 3.3 volts. So if you plug it into a 120-volt or a 240-volt circuit, it'll just go pop. Second, they're expecting DC instead of AC. Thankfully, we don't normally deal with them as discrete components like this in theater. The three most common forms that we use here are lamps, tapes, and fixtures. Retrofit lamps just screw into a normal light socket and replace an incandescent or CFL lamp. The ballast that converts the power from AC to DC is right here in the base, and some of the fancier ones can even be dimmed, although it does tend to get a little flickery at the low end and usually pops in and out quite noticeably. Amusingly enough, you also dim LEDs by turning them on and off. However, since they don't have the tungsten filament and thus the thermal inertia of an old incandescent lamp, you have to turn them on and off far more quickly than our old dimmers are capable of. This oscilloscope is showing two traces. The bottom one is a conventional dimmer at 50%. The top one is an LED dimmer at 50%. you can see that the top one is turning on and off much more quickly. Fixtures are whole instruments with LEDs built into them. They are normally designed to take in non-dimmed power and then be controlled via DMX. Now, this means that they're not trying to run their ballast and their brain off of the chopped up dimmed power, so they usually dim a lot more smoothly and without that sort of flickery pop in and pop out, although that will depend on how much you paid for them. This one was $14, it's not that great. Some fixtures, like this Chauvet here, can run either on dimmed power or non-dimmed power with DMX control, which means that if you get one of these, you can just drop it straight into your existing lighting rig, or you can control it via DMX. All right, here we have our two Chauvets. This one is hooked directly to a dimmer. This one is hooked to non-dim power and then controlled via DMX. One important note, LED does not necessarily mean color changing. This Chauvet fixture here, for example, is just a warm white. If I want this to be a color, I have to put a gel in front of it like it's a normal old source 4. The reason that we got these is that they use about half as much power as a normal source 4, which is really nice when you're doing a show in the middle of nowhere and everything has to be plugged into wall outlets and you're not quite sure if they're on different circuits or not. LED tape is a flexible tape that made out of plastic and rubber and has LEDs mounted on it. It's available in white or in single colors, or this one is even RGB color mixing. It's designed so that you can cut it apart and then mount it on whatever nutty project your designer has come up with. We will cover this in more depth in another episode dedicated entirely to LEDs, but do know that it does require a special power supply for it that takes in non-dim power and DMX and then drives your LED tapes as desired. So to sum up what we've just learned, incandescent lights, very inefficient, but because you're just running electricity through a wire, heating it up, they're also very forgiving of you messing with that power in various silly ways. Fluorescents and LEDs, they're much more efficient, but they are also much more particular in their power requirements. So hopefully, next time a director comes up to you and says, hey, can we put those fluorescent tubes on a dimmer? You'll now be able to explain why that's not going to work. Well, good luck. Anyway, that's all for now, and thank you for watching. Channel B to ground to mode switch to channel B.